My name is Robert Pine. I'm Senior Director for Community Engagement here at the college, and I have the privilege of overseeing the Norman Miller Center for Peace, Justice, and Public Understanding. And we are very proud to host this series of lectures. This lecture series was established in 1993 by the Norman Miller Family Foundation, honoring the life of Lewis Miller, who had died just a few years earlier. At that time, Norman Miller, an area developer and longtime advocate for human rights, stated, "I am pleased that my brother's name will be memorialized through a continuing series of lectures at St. Norbert College that will promote peace and better understanding." When Norman himself passed away in 2008, his name was added to the title of these annual lectures. So, continuing the legacy of the men for which it is named, the Norman and Lewis Miller Lecture in Public Understanding promotes unity, communication, and tolerance among different cultures, religions, ethnicities, and traditions. The lecture series celebrates human dignity and encourages better understanding between people both domestically and internationally. Now, some of you have been here for far more of these lectures than I have, highlighted by such wonderful speakers as Arthur Schlesinger Jr., Benjamin Barber, Gustav Niebuhr, Reverend James Forbes, William Sloan Coffin, David Halberstam, Leonard Pitts Jr., Elie Wiesel, Martin Marty, Amy Jill Levine, Eboo Patel, John Paul Lederach. So we continue that really wonderful legacy tonight with Aziz Abu Sarah, who I'll introduce in just a few minutes. You can find a full list of past lectures on the website for the Norman Miller Center, and you'll see that address, that website address, on the backs of your program. You'll also find there some information about our center, which would hopefully also help you find some ways in which you might be able to get involved. We do a whole lot more than just this lecture series, although this is the only time I see some of you. As you come to campus to see us, I'd like to encourage all of you to stop by at our table in the back afterward to have a look at some of the information about our upcoming trip to Israel and Palestine. We were there last summer. Dr. Robert Kramer and I led a trip, and we were working with Aziz's tour company, MEJDI Tours. You'll hear a little bit more about them in a bit. But that particular trip, we're able to see all the important and familiar places that one would typically expect to see in a trip to the Holy Land. But at the same time, we connect with people from every different walk of life and different political echelons and religious leaders. So that we met with leaders from Christian, Jewish, Muslim communities, Druze community. Met with politicians ranging from the Israeli Foreign Ministry to the chief spokesperson for the PLO. We had meals in people's homes in the West Bank and in Jerusalem and in Tel Aviv. And it's really an unbelievable opportunity that truly reflects the relational priority of our speaker that you'll hear from this evening. I'd like to acknowledge the student workers who've been directing traffic a little bit for you all. We have a great team of student workers at the Norman Miller Center, Maggie McConaughey, Fuad Al-Khoury, Megan Steiner, Crystal Benversi, and Abigail Planky. And I'm especially grateful for the matchless professional skills of our program coordinator, Catherine Udelhoffen, who unfortunately is not able to be here tonight because of a recent surgery on her wrist. And those of you who are familiar with this lecture series and with the way I'm normally able to coast along on Catherine's coattails, you have sensed her absence this evening. Also like to acknowledge President Tom Kunkel and members of the President's Cabinet who are here tonight, especially Father Jay Fostner, who's our Vice President of Mission and Student Affairs. Earlier this evening, we recognized the winners of the Norman Miller Essay in Public Understanding, and we'd like to thank the Green Bay Press Gazette once again for co-sponsoring that contest and doing the final round of judging and providing the trophies for it. Special thanks to Peter Frank and Robert Rizzo from the Press Gazette who join us here along with Pamela Henson, the regional president of Gannett, Wisconsin Media. We'd also like to thank Ho-Chunk Nation for providing an iPad for the first place winner, who is Ashley Streeter from Lodi High School, who received that iPad and a $2,000 scholarship to St. Norbert College. Second place was Haley Sclerata from Wauwatosa East High School. And then third place was Emily Dolan from Lord's Academy in Oshkosh. And both Haley and Emily received $1,000 scholarships to SNC. And we're very pleased that all three of these winners have enrolled and will be here in the fall. So we're very pleased for that. Well, now for the main event. I first met Aziz Abu Sarah through our good friend Mark Bakkenauer, who is professor of geography here at SNC. He introduced us electronically, and then I first met Aziz at a nice hotel in Jerusalem for breakfast out in the sun and plotting all good things. One of the many hats that Aziz wears is that of being a National Geographic explorer. And it pretty much means that he travels all over the world as an ambassador for the National Geographic Society, speaking to educators, conferences, and other gatherings. And if you check out his Facebook page, which you can see over here, you'll see that if you have even a little bit of a travel bug, this is pretty much the coolest job ever. Now, I will say that Aziz does a lot more than just post selfies on those websites, but he does do a lot of that. And they're typically in some extraordinary places. Aziz is a cultural educator and a peace builder. So he uses tourism to bring people together, like with the trip that several of us took this last year. He does this in many different parts of the world, not just in the Middle East. He also does it in Europe and in Latin America, talking about starting some new projects also in Africa. He has led trips in Cuba, so he's doing some amazing traveling and reconciliation work simultaneously. And again, on these trips, you're sharing meals with people and connecting with them in long, extended conversations so that you're not just learning narratives, you're building friendships. And it really changes the way you look at the world and look at its history. Dr. Bob Kramer, who has been teaching on this topic for some 27 years, said that he's never seen a better way to learn about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict than that two-week trip that we did this last summer. So again, it testifies to the nature and effectiveness of this work that Aziz is doing. Aziz has been changing the way people do tourism, and he's also been doing much more than just leading trips and taking pictures. He's also deeply involved in reconciliation and community development projects in Syria, Afghanistan, Iran, Latin America, and quite honestly, if I just keep blathering on about him, you won't ever get to hear him. So please welcome Aziz Abu Sarah.
Thank you. Good evening. How are you doing? Thank you for inviting me to Wisconsin. It's been a few years since I've been here, and I see some faces I know. Hello. They've traveled with me a couple of years ago to Jerusalem, so thank you. You drove from Milwaukee, am I right? So thank you for coming. And thank you for a great welcome. I mean, the snow outside, that was so nice of you. Arranging such a warm welcome for me. I'm a big fan. No. I've tried to escape this year. You know, global warming has worked fine for me. I'm like, I'm in Washington, D.C., and it hasn't been that bad. And the one time it snowed, I was in Brazil. I was like, yes, I got my times right, except with Wisconsin. Should have been last week. Next time. Well, I thought I will start with telling you a little bit about myself. Bob mentioned, I'm a National Geographic explorer, and it's something people don't expect for what I do, because my background is peace building and education, and when I talk about being a National Geographic explorer, what is the first thing people think about when they think of an explorer? Who they think about when they think of an explorer? Are you going to help me? Come on. Yeah? An archaeologist? Indiana Jones? These kind of things. So you can see, I'm kind of trying to look like that here, putting the hat with the camera. And that's not exactly what I do. And I remember when I got an email from National Geographic about 6 years ago. I didn't know I was being considered to be named an explorer. I got this email, and the email went, "Congratulations, you have been named as a National Geographic explorer." And I looked at it, and I'm thinking, I don't think so. So what do you do in that kind of situation when you get those emails? "Congratulations, you've won $1 million. What do you do with these emails? Yeah, I deleted it. I'm like, yeah, right, you're not getting my money. Not that I had that much anyway. So I deleted the email, and then soon after I got another email, "Have you received our email about becoming an explorer?" And I'm like, these people really after my money. No, delete. And eventually, a few days later, I got a phone call, and the call was, "Hey, have you been receiving our emails? We want you to become an explorer in our society." And I thought, oh, you are serious. Great, yeah, sure. And I called one of my good friends right away, and I said, "Guess what? National Geographic just called me, and they said they want me to be an explorer." And his first words were, "Why?" Which is when you figure out you should really find some new friends. Then his second thing, we worked together in a university at George Mason University at that time, and he said, "Explorer for what? Oh, maybe you will explore our faculty fridge so you can find out some old antiquity, you know, those old sandwiches that some professor have left, and, you know, you can find out all about them right now." So this is what brought me into National Geographic. And in reality, I think it's amazing that they were looking at educator and at peacemakers to be an explorers, because it is being on the front line of exploration, looking at how to bring peace between different groups, looking at how we expand the way we're doing education. I'll be talking about a couple of these things. But before that, I would like to start by telling you a little bit about myself. Tell you a little bit about my life. I didn't grow up as a peacemaker or as an entrepreneur or as somebody interested in education. I grew up exactly on the opposite side. I grew up in a place called Jerusalem. Anybody heard of it before? It's a little famous. And I grew up in a place of conflict zone. I was 7 years old. I remember when my mom would send me to school, my bag to go to school was a little different than probably what you would have had when you went to school. So let's try. What did your mom give you when you went to school? What is that?
A little bag.
A little bag. Yeah. How about you?
Lunch.
Yeah, food is important. What do you think? Books. Yeah, those are the things you take with you to school. My mom gave me every day a fresh onion. Fresh onion. Anybody knows why? You guys have never rioted before, right? Tear gas, exactly. Just in case you need it one day, if you ever go to a protest, always carry with you a fresh onion, because if you fire that tear gas, you cut the onion, you put it close to your nose, and it actually might help you survive if you shot at tear gas. Here we go. I might have saved your life if you ever go to a protest. You didn't know this will be a crash course on protesting and rioting. But this is, for me, I grew up really thinking every kid around the world, when you go to school, you carry an onion with you. And it took me so many years later until I figured out that probably the way you grew up is a bit different than the way I grew up. When I was 7 years old, my mom, I remember watching television and seeing people throwing rocks. Now, when you're 7 years old, you don't really understand politics. You don't understand what's going on. These things don't make much sense to you. And I watched these people throwing rocks, and I thought, my neighborhood is boring. There was no playground. There was no community centers. We finished school at 12, and there was nothing to do after that. So I watched this throwing rocks thing, and I thought, this sounds like a fun thing to do. I can't believe I was too dumb to think about that. So I went and talked to my gang of friends, you know, all 6, 7, and 8 years old, and we decided we're going to get to the closest road, and we're going to throw some rocks, which we did. We got to the closest road, and we threw some rocks. Now, apparently, as a Palestinian, I was supposed to throw rocks at Israeli cars. We didn't know that. So we threw rocks at our neighbor's cars, which they did not find that cute at all, no. And we got quite a nice conversation and punishment from our parents that evening. But this is what it means to grow up in a conflict zone. Eventually, we figured out where's, quote unquote, the right road to throw rocks. And when we did and we hit one of the buses, a guy walks out of the bus and starts shooting at us. And when you're 7 years old, you don't understand what does that even mean. You think you're invincible. You don't think I might get hurt. You don't think I might get shot. And it gives you so much adrenaline, and you run away, and this becomes your life. And you're getting traumatized, but you don't even know that. You don't understand that this is who you are. This is your life now. This is me when I was a little kid. I'm the younger one here. This is me when I used to look good back in the days. I saw a neighbor of mine a couple of years ago, and she said, I haven't seen her since I was a little kid. And she gave me a hug and was crying and in tears, and she said, I remember you when you looked cute. It's exactly what a guy likes to hear from women, you know. Thank you. I'm the youngest of 7. I'm what you call the oops child. My parents did not plan on having me. My family is Muslim, religious, which really takes the excuse away from my parents. How did the mistake happen? There was no wine involved in it. They can't use that excuse. But it meant being born much later. My older brother here in the photo, he's the one just older than me, Taysir, was 9 years older than me. And my parents had enough kids already, and they were tired of raising kids. So they decided Taysir is the person who's going to be in charge of my life. So my first day in school, he was the person who took me to school. Everything I did, he was the person in charge of it. And we had this very close relationship with each other. When I was 9 years old, a group of soldiers came into our home. It was Ramadan, which we fast from sunrise to sunset, no food, no water. And you get up before the fasting starts so you can drink a lot of water, eat something, and we did that. And right before, just as we were going back to bed, the soldiers broke in, came and arrested Taysir. He was arrested on suspicion of throwing rocks at soldiers. He refused to confess, which meant he was beaten up until he eventually did. By the time he did confess, he ended up having a lot of health complications as a result of it. He had a liver failure, had a spleen failure. He was sentenced for 1 year in prison. He was released before the year has passed. We took him to a hospital right away after he was released. He had a surgery, but it was too late to do anything. And so a few days after the surgery, he ended up dying in the hospital. I was 10 years old when that happened. And I want you to imagine being a 10 years old, watching your own brother being killed. How would that make you feel? I was angry. I was bitter. I was full of rage. And the only thought that could come to my mind is revenge, because it feels at that point that it is your duty to avenge. It is your duty to do that. If you are a good brother, how could you not do that? It almost feels like if I just walk down here and I punch you right in the face, what the first thing you would do? Punch me back. Thank you for your honesty. Yeah, how many of you, if somebody punches you in the face, you go, wait a second, let me take a few steps back and think about this logically. How many of us do that? Most of us, if somebody hurts you, if somebody punches you, we don't think about it. We react right away. If you hurt me, I want to hurt you back. And that's how I grew up. For the next 8 years of my life, all I did was trying to figure ways to revenge. And in my mind, I justified it by thinking it was about justice, because the line between justice and revenge is quite a thin line. We always think we are out for justice when too many times we are out for revenge, and those are two different things. And that I learned much, much later. I became an editor for a youth magazine. I was 16. That was a political youth magazine. I became one of the Fatah youth leaders in Jerusalem. I was actively in protesting and throwing rocks and doing all that kind of stuff, writing. I was writing every week a column or two about revenge and about how we should never compromise, kind of similar to some media at the moment, all over. But when I was 18 years old, I realized I had a problem. See, I was 18, living in Jerusalem, just 100 meters from my school. There was a Jewish school. We never met, never talked. I did not speak a word in Hebrew, even though it was mandatory in my high school to learn Hebrew. But I managed to go 3 years not learning one word. I still passed all my exams. Not going to tell you how I did that, since there are too many students here. Don't follow that example. But I passed through my exams, finished, and I realized I'm stuck. I'm in Jerusalem, and if you don't speak Hebrew in Jerusalem, your chances of going to college, finding work, getting going in life is not going to be that good. So I started looking for the best place to learn Hebrew. Anybody knows where's the best place in Jerusalem to learn Hebrew? It's called Ulpan. So if you from here and you emigrate to Israel, you would go to an Ulpan. It's specially made for new immigrants, Jewish new immigrants to Israel. And I went to the Ulpan, and I was the only Palestinian sitting in a classroom where pretty much everybody else was Jewish. And like I said, up until this point, the only people I have met on the other side were pretty much interactions with soldiers, with settlers, which we didn't get along. And even though we lived 200 meters from each other, so close, yet we were so far, never had an interaction. Now, people often tell me, oh, I can't believe this happened, but I'll tell you something. I live in Washington, D.C. now, in Washington, D.C. area. The same thing can happen here as well. There are neighborhoods that are 5 minutes walk or drive from us that we also don't go to, and that can happen in the U.S. as much as it happened back there. But I realized at that point, you know, I came into the classroom, actually. I had a plan. I'm going to learn Hebrew, but I'm not going to talk to anybody here, which apparently is not the way you learn a language. That would put us into smaller groups and let us talk to each other and ask questions like, how are you? Where are you from? What do you like? And slowly we start liking each other. But we didn't have enough Hebrew to talk about anything meaningful. So we talk about things that were less meaningful, I guess. Argue about things, because that's the Middle East for you. We'll argue about coffee, for example. And my Israeli friends in that classroom would be talking about the best coffee, which in their opinion, for some reason, was something called Nescafe, instant coffee. It's horrible. It's the worst coffee. I mean, there's things you are willing to do for peace, but that kind of, there's a limit to what you can do. And Nescafe is going one day to sue me for this. We'll see. And I would explain to them that, no, this is, you need to try Arabic coffee, the real thing. If you haven't tried Arabic coffee, you haven't tried coffee yet. And they will say, but you don't understand. And here's a class in Hebrew. They will say, Nescafe, think about it. It's two words. It's Nes and Cafe, which in Hebrew means Nes, miracle, the miracle coffee. Like, really, I'm from Jerusalem. We have some real miracles here. This ain't impressing me. You got to try a bit harder. But we'll argue about things like this, and then we'll agree on other things like music. Well, only with a couple of people I agree on that. I'm the biggest fan in the Middle East of something called Western country music. Any fans of country music here? Oh, gee, that were more in my class in Jerusalem than you. Really, nobody? Who's your favorite?
I just like
All right. So my favorite is Johnny Cash. Oh, look, everyone now, yeah, Johnny Cash. Like, he's not country music. Yeah, right, you take all the good ones and then you say, we can't work that way. Johnny Cash, Tim McGraw, Brad Paisley. I go to these concerts and I wear a cowboy hat and I have boots, I have the buckle belt, you know, and got it all figured out. And the only thing is, instead of doing tailgating with hot dogs and burgers, I do kebab. I'm not making this up. And instead of beer, I take scotch, which they tell me is still not really fully American. You have to get over that part. But yeah, we would talk about country music, and I thought that was amazing, is having that experience. And through that, I realized how segregated and separated we are and how harmful that is, because we lived so close, but we were so divided. We were divided by a wall, but not just a physical wall. This is a wall that does separate us. But this, in my opinion, is the easier wall to overcome. I'm talking about a much more powerful wall, the wall that's in our minds, the wall that is in our hearts, the wall of anger, the wall of ignorance, the wall of fear. Those are the real walls that we have. And it's so hard to see the other as long as you're afraid of them, angry at them, hate them. And we live in a place where we all had these feelings. And in that classroom, these walls were being cracked. These walls were starting to fall. And as they started to fall, I started making friends. And those friends became part of my life. And the teacher who taught me in that classroom became part of my life. And suddenly, when something happened in Jerusalem, we didn't think as something happened to them. You started thinking something happened where my friends live. And you start making a phone call to check on your friend. And suddenly the other is not anymore the other. And that's one of the first things I learned, is to step out of my comfort zone. Going into that classroom was stepping out of my comfort zone. Learning about the other, learning something that I didn't know. And I took that to heart. After that, as I said, I grew up in a Muslim family. I went to an evangelical Bible college for a couple of years where I studied biblical studies. My parents were like, this is not going to go well. Great Bible college. And then, as if that wasn't enough, I ended up working in an ultra-Orthodox Jewish neighborhood. And they're like, is he going to convert to Christianity or Judaism? Which one do we prefer? That's But stepping out of our comfort zone forces us to learn things that we didn't know. And it's very hard. It's very tough. But it's very important as well. And I remember one of the first things I wanted to learn was about the Holocaust. Because growing up as a Palestinian, I knew nothing about it. And suddenly, every conversation I was having with these new friends, something would come up. And I didn't know, because the idea is you don't learn things that will make you sympathize with people you consider as an enemy. And so I thought, this has to change. And I went to the Holocaust Memorial in Jerusalem. This was back in 1999. I didn't know any Palestinian who've done that before. I got there and I realized I was the only Palestinian in the place, and most of the people were in uniform. Most were Jewish, and I started feeling very uncomfortable because I thought everyone was judging me of being there. It's like, what are they thinking? What's happening here? They probably don't want me to be here. And you have all these thoughts going in your mind. Then as I'm walking through, I'm also having all these guards of like, I'm here to learn. I can't sympathize. But slowly, as I walked it through, that started changing. And the only thought that would go through my mind is, how could we have done this as people, as humans to each other? How do we get so crazy, so full of hatred, so full of anger that we're willing to massacre each other? And I finished that tour of the museum, and I decided to write about it. And I wrote an article for a newspaper called Haaretz. And the article was not about Israel and Palestine. It was just about how I felt going to the Holocaust Memorial. And I decided I'm not going to write about the occupation. I'm not going to write about my brother. I'm not going to write about anything I went through. I said, I'm going to just write about what I felt, what I learned. I'm going to write about sympathizing and feeling with, you know, what I went through walking through this memorial. And I published it. A few days later, I started getting all these emails. And it was quite weird because normally, for you who write in newspapers, normally it doesn't matter what you write about, you're going to get quite a lot of angry comments, especially in Israel. Doesn't matter what article it is, the first 50 comments are about how horrible you are as a human being, and the next 50 about how your ideas are horrible and so on. And this was different. The response was almost all positive. And people were writing me stuff like, thank you for writing about us. Thank you for learning about us. What can we do to learn about your story? What do you recommend a place we can go and visit? What kind of book we could read that would make us learn your narrative, your history, your story? And that was incredible because I spent, and we do that, I spent my whole life trying to push my narrative, trying to tell my story, the story of living under occupation, the story of living without equal rights. I didn't have any citizenship until I got my citizenship in the States. I grew up without any papers. I had travel documents. For me to travel anywhere was a nightmare. I didn't have any rights to vote. But I didn't write about any of that, but I always wanted to push that and wanted people to hear about it. And it was only when I did the opposite, when I said, I want to listen, I want to learn, I want to sympathize, that people were willing to listen to my story and were asking about how can we learn also about your side of it. But I wanted to go beyond that. Now, I kept thinking about what can we make us really break those walls to learn about the other. So last year, I started with a Jewish friend of mine, Danny Varadi, a project called I Am Your Protector. And I'm Your Protector is this idea that can help us learn about the other, but in a positive way. Learn about tough topics in a positive way. For example, the Holocaust. We thought, how can we get more Muslims to learn about the Holocaust without getting them to right away say no? And we started looking at stories. Stories of Muslims who saved Jews in the Holocaust. Stories that I didn't know even existed before. And we were quite surprised to find not one or two or three, finding hundreds of these stories quite easily. Stories like this man who was head of the Institute of the Great Mosque in Paris. And what he did, he was forging letters for the Jewish community there, saying they were Muslim so they would not be shipped to concentration camps. To do that, he put his life in danger. Stories like the community in Albania. Albania is the only country in Europe that the number of Jews after World War II actually increased instead of decreasing, increased multiple times instead of decreasing. That's the only country in Europe where the majority of people who live there are Muslim. These are amazing stories, and we thought instead of going and saying, just learn about the Holocaust, we said, what if we make this part of learning also about yourself and give them a feeling that we were part of the people who protected Jews. Obviously, there were also some who didn't. But we wanted to focus on the ones who did because those are the examples we want to follow. And we found that the same people who would say, no, I don't want to learn, I don't care, you tell them these stories and suddenly they flipped 180 degrees. And suddenly they were interested. In all over, in places like Pakistan, which we never thought we would be able to bring exhibits about the Holocaust, being able to do exhibits and talking about this. Places in Palestine, places here in the States, in Europe, and all over. Not only in that, we decided, what if we flip it? What if we find also Jewish protectors of Muslims? And we found people like this man, Jacob Finci. Jacob is from Bosnia. And when the war was going on in Bosnia, he opened his synagogue and hid tons of Muslims in the synagogue to save them from being killed. A story that most Muslims have not heard, and most Jews have not heard before. And we started finding many, many, many more of these kind of stories. And wherever, and we started in Jewish, Muslim, and Israeli, and Palestinian, but eventually we were able to find other things for every community. Things like refugees, for example, where I was in I was in Amsterdam recently, and I met with this Syrian guy who was a refugee, and he was walking in Amsterdam and saw a man, Dutch man, who fell in a canal. It's freezing cold. Everybody took their phones and started filming. And he looked at them and he said, the guy is dying. And they said, yeah, but if you jump, you would die. And he said, yeah, but he's dying. Somebody has to do something. And he jumps in the water. And because they were all filming, we actually have the film of it. And he saved this man from drowning. And often when we hear about refugees, we get the bad stories, the bad rep. And this guy's story became a big story there. And we started looking, are there more? And we found tons of these kind of stories. So we're now looking at stories across any gender, ethnic, religious, political divides, where people step up for each other and work as a community to defend each other. So learning about each other. The second thing I started focusing on is challenging stereotypes that we have. And I learned something important from a friend, Betty Williams, who's a Nobel Peace Laureate from Northern Ireland. She started one of the first schools to bring Catholic and Protestant kids to study together. And in the beginning, she realized that kids weren't yet getting it. So she thought the best thing to do is to bring someone who's not Catholic and not Protestant so they can understand that the world is a little bigger than just Catholics and Protestants. So who to bring? A Buddhist. That would be a good idea. She brought a Buddhist monk, and the monk started talking, finished an hour of conversation with the kids, left, and she asked him, what did you think? And the kids went, this was incredible. It was amazing. It was so good. But we have one question. I said, sure, what is it? And they said, this Buddhist monk, is he Catholic or Protestant? Stereotypes are quite powerful things, and one of the best ways to break it is through directly challenging those stereotypes by exposure. So one of the first things I did after my Hebrew class was join and eventually leading an organization called Bereaved Families Forum. The Bereaved Families Forum is 500-600 families now of Israelis and Palestinians who all lost a family member in the conflict. This is one of those. His name is Rami Hanan. Rami is an Israeli Jew. His father was in Auschwitz. He fought as a soldier in the 1973 war. His daughter, when she was 14 years old, was killed in a suicide bombing in Jerusalem. You can tell Rami and I are good friends from this photo. People look at us and think it's impossible for us to be friends, and yet we and those crazy 600 families are not just friends, are people who understand each other, understand the pain that we had. Because at the end of the day, our loss is similar. Our tears are as bitter, our blood is the same color, and our pain is the same. And we understood that instead of using our pain to hate each other, we should use it as an example to bring people together. Because pain is very powerful. It's almost like a nuclear power. And you can use that for destruction, or you can use that for hope. And so one of the projects we decided to do together was to go to high schools, looking at our stories. Rami tells me that he was in his late 40s when he first time had a conversation with a Palestinian. He's like me, from Jerusalem. He was in his late 40s. We live there, but we don't have that conversation. We never have that chance. And so when you don't, you demonize, you dehumanize those who you don't know. And so we decided, let's go to high schools together. Not you to the Israeli school and me to the Palestinian schools. No, let's visit them together and let's have those conversations. Let's break those stereotypes. And so we would go to Israeli classrooms and we will tell our stories. I will tell my story about my brother and he will tell his story about his daughter. And then we would look at them and we'll say, look at us. We are not enemies. We are not here to tell you we hate each other. We are here to tell you if we could break the cycle of violence and this hatred, then everyone could and everyone should. And that's the message we were going. And it wasn't easy. was quite hard because we would walk into a classroom and we would ask if it's an Israeli classroom, how many of you have met a Palestinian before? And nobody would raise their hands. And then you would ask, what do you think of Palestinians? And everybody got an opinion. And normally it wasn't the nicest one. And then we'll go to a Palestinian classroom and we'll say, how many of you have met an Israeli who wasn't a soldier? And none of them would raise their hands. And then when you ask them their opinion, the same thing. And then for the first time, they had a chance to talk to somebody. And they would be angry in the beginning and they'll yell at us sometimes and they have really good questions. And ironically, 90%, I would say, of the questions were similar to each other about, we want peace, but they don't want peace. And then we'll go through all of that. And by the end of it, the same classroom that in the beginning are sitting like this going, I don't want him to be here. Suddenly, the same people are loosening up and going, this was amazing. I never heard anything like this. This is making me rethink. You guys should run for politics. Appreciate that, but no. Want to keep some dignity, you know. But this is how you break stereotype. Another project we did together was showing people what numbers mean. When the numbers of people who were killed in the Second Intifada reached 12, Second Uprising reached 1,200, we brought 1,200 empty coffins in front of the United Nations in New York. And we covered it with Israeli and Palestinian flags, and we brought the families of those who were killed. To give a message to people, say, it's not numbers, it's names, it's people who are behind it. And when you hear 1,000, 5,000, 20,000, it really makes no difference. But when you hear the stories and see the faces and hear the names, that makes a difference. We started to challenge the whole idea that people don't want to talk to each other. We said, if you're curious, we can get you to talk in a safe way. Oops. In a safe way to each other. We set up a phone line where you could dial free line and you can connect to somebody from the other side. And in the first couple of years, we ended up with over 1 million phone calls between Israelis and Palestinians. This is a place that has altogether about 10 million people. So that was some hope, and there is some hope. And just a few hundred people were able to do that and change so many lives. So breaking stereotypes is the other thing I was working on. Oops, before I go in the second thing, I want to give you an example of another way to break a stereotype. And it's a mix from a trip I did to Brazil a couple of years ago to cover a sport most Americans don't care much about. Its real name is football, but for your benefit, I called it soccer in the video. And while there, we filmed about the World Cup, and we did this video for National Geographic, but we also filmed with Israeli and Palestinian kids playing soccer together. So I want to show you this video. What makes soccer loved all over the world is that it doesn't need any infrastructure, it doesn't need language abilities. Anybody can play it. All you need is just a ball. And so everywhere in the world, people play soccer. Everywhere in the world, they love soccer. My name is Aziz Abu Sarah. I'm a cultural educator and a peacemaker, and I'm here in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. I came here to watch the World Cup matches, but also to learn about this country and meet new people and make new friendships. Growing up, to me, soccer was as much part of my life as eating and drinking and going to school. I played soccer every day. I watched every match possible. It was something that took us out of the reality of the Middle East into a whole different world. In Israel and Palestine, I worked with Israeli and Palestinian kids, bringing them together to play together in the same team, not Israelis versus Palestinians, but actually mixing the teams together.
This is Mohammed, this is Yusuf.
And the moment they got in the field, they forgot all differences. Language didn't matter, color didn't matter, what religion they are didn't matter. All mattered is whether you can play or not. Soccer is a great way of intercultural exchange because every team, whether they intended for it or not, are bringing some of their culture into the games. Their fans are bringing their colors, their music, their dances, and you get to learn about that. Even sometimes some of their beliefs.
One cultural thing that people have learned in this World Cup is about the Muslim players who had to fast because of the month of Ramadan from sunrise to sunset, not eating and not drinking. And having to play while fasting is really hard. And so it's been a great experience and a great learning experience for everybody.
You know, when we brought these kids together, we told them, you're going to play football. And they said, yeah, great. We're going to play the Arabs versus the Jews. Like, wonderful. No, we're going to actually break you down into two different teams, and it will be mixed Arabs and Jews. And most of them were like, I'm not happy, but fine, I'll do it. Soccer is more important. But a couple of kids said, no, we will not do that. And they sat on the side and said, we will not play. And we decided, fine, you can watch. And so the kids started playing. About 5-10 minutes in, those kids will come to us one by one and go, okay, I know there are a couple Palestinians there, but they're really good. I'll go and play with them. And then another kid will come and says, I know they have these Jewish kids there, but they seem to be good scorers. I'll go and play with them. And suddenly, really, the idea of who's Arab and who's Jewish didn't matter. But these kids have never met each other before, never had that interaction. And when you don't, as we said, you create all kind of ideas of who's the person on the other side, and you're justifying your anger and your hatred and your resentment against those on the other side. Now, I wanted to move to a different topic, because I worked a lot in Israel and Palestine, but I also worked outside Israel and Palestine. And I feel that it's important when I talk about my work and my journey to not just stick to that, because there are many other issues around that are important to us and important, I hope, to you as well. And for a while, I worked in a university at George Mason. I directed the Center on Conflict Resolution there. And one of the things we did was experiential education, which I feel is very important for bringing people together for that journey for peace. Because as we study, it's important to get out of the classroom and to go out and do things. And so we were taking students, just like the trip Bob is doing, going, taking students to conflict zones, which my university liked so much. Our lawyers were so excited as I was telling them the places we had in mind. Because you're doing Jerusalem. I was going on the border with Syria and getting phone calls like, you can't do that. We're going to get sued by everybody. But we'll go to places very close to, we got pretty much 200 meters from the border with Syria, and we were learning about the Syrian conflict and what's happening there. And we'll go to Jerusalem, we'll go to Indonesia, we'll go to the Balkans, and we'll go to Jordan, and we'll go to all these places learning about different conflicts around the world. And as we did that, we were learning about the refugee issue. And we're learning about the 10 million Syrians who were displaced from their homes. 10 million. That's half of the population. But what was amazing to me, because again, the numbers don't really make so much of an impact, was meeting those people. And realizing over half of the people I was meeting were kids. Over half of these people displaced from their homes were kids. And so after the students left, we didn't take them with us. Me and a colleague decided we need to cross the line and go into Syria and learn more. And we did that. And as we walked in, we were just hit by how many kids are not able to go to school, how many kids have not been to school in 3-4 years, and we're hearing all these stories of just not having enough supplies, not having anything they can do, and we're trying to figure out, how do you tell that story? How do we bring these stories to people? How do we work on peace building in these situations? And it's extremely difficult to do that, because you hit with images that's so hard to live with. This is an example from Zaatari camp. It's from about a couple of years ago. Zaatari camp in Jordan, I was there, took this photo. It was 150,000 people were there. And the moment you're in a refugee camp, just so you know, it's not that you get a tent and that's it. You You can't leave the refugee camp. You're not allowed to leave the refugee camp. You're stuck there. This is the only thing you do for life. And this kid lived for about a year there. But when you ask him, his name is Ahmed, when you ask him, where did you come from? Where did you grow up? He will say the refugee camp, because he does not remember a time he did not live in the refugee camp. This is the only home he knew. But when I met him, he was coming to me from the tents in the back, and I was waiting to take a shot. And then I realized when he left the tent, he was not happy. It was very hot. And he's walking closer to me, and he's very upset. And then a smile started getting on his face. And it was kind of nice to watch that. And he's getting closer, so I'm getting my camera ready. And he's getting closer, and then he goes down, and he picks up the thing in his hand. Anybody can tell what that thing is? What is it? Candy wrap. Yeah, it's a piece of trash. And he was so excited, because that was the only toy he could have. And I thought, this is amazing. These are stories that need to be told. This is how you connect to what people go through. But then it hit me. This is the story from my perspective. It's not the story from his perspective. So I started thinking, how could we tell the stories from their point of view? So with National Geographic, we ended up bringing some cameras, some of our best photographers, and do a photo camp. What that means, we brought cameras with us, gave it to the kids, and spent time teaching them how to use these cameras. And then we told them, you go, you take the photos you want, and you come and you tell us your own stories. Now, if you've lost your home, you had to escape being bombed the whole way out of your country, you end up in a refugee camp, you haven't been going to school for years, what are the stories you're going to tell? What are the photos you're going to take? Now, you see what I did. Their story was different. These are some of the photos these kids took. It's extremely different than the story I was giving you. It's the people they cared about, the relationships they had. Now, this pissed me off, because I was like, they're becoming better photographers in 2 days. And me holding these professional cameras and not able to think of something as innovative as this themselves. But still, extremely artistic. This kid had to quit school so he can put his sister in school. So he works, she goes to school. That was his story. Again, innovation, a bird, I don't know, maybe freedom. And obviously, the most important thing is football. But what I learned through that, something that's very important for our road, our journey for peace, is that everyone I was meeting has processed their trauma in one of two ways. They either process their trauma as a victim, which means a narrative of besiegement, a narrative of me, a narrative of the whole world is against me, everything is just horrible. And trust me, if there's somebody justified to say that, it is a refugee. It is somebody who lost everything. But those were reliving their trauma every day. And then the other side were these kids who processed their trauma as a survivor, not as a victim. Who said, yes, I suffered. Yes, I had a tough time, but I overcome. I see my story as part of a bigger narrative, a grander thing. I see my life about more than just myself. And then I came back to the States and I realized it's not only about refugees. It's everyone I meet in general. People define themselves as either victims and the whole world and everybody, and there are so many things against them, or they define themselves as survivors, where they think not only about themselves and their lives and what's good for them, but also about others, also about those in need other than themselves. And I met one person who was really important in explaining that.
This is Anwar Sayed. She's a Syrian girl who wrote this letter in English as we did our program, and you don't need to try to read it. I'll read it for you. She said, now she hasn't been going to school for 3 years, by the way. She's about 14 years old, I believe, here. She said, to whom it may concern, these words I read every day on my UNHCR asylum seeker certificate. I am a Syrian child. The only thing I hope in the world is to wake up from this terrible nightmare and to return to my friends, to return to my life, to return to my home before this war. And if the time goes back, I just want to play with the people who lost their lives. And I will ask them to leave Syria. I never thought that I would live in a tent, but that's all right. I never thought I would not listen to my English teacher, who I love so much, in Syria, but that's all right. I never thought I would not breathe the smells of Syrian fields in the summer night, but that's all right. But to whom it may concern, please stop war and let me go back to my past life. Do you see a victim or a survivor in this letter? It's amazing. A girl who's 14 years old, who hasn't been going to school, who lost everything they had, including family, friends, and yet her idea, her vision, is something positive. And you know, as I started working there, I had people who would tell me, why are you going to work in Syria? You're from Palestine. Focus on your own thing. And that's a victim of the narrative of victims. Let's focus only on my story and my issue and the things that are relevant to me. And I thought, you can't. If you start thinking in isolationist way where it's only about me, building that narrative of besiegement, you're giving up who you are. You're giving up morality. You're giving up. You lose yourself through doing that. And of everything I've done, this has been one of the most meaningful things I've done in my life. But as I did all of these projects, there's something always stuck in my mind. I worked in Afghanistan. I worked in Syria. I worked on Iran. I worked on all these different conflict areas. And one thing that kept sticking out is sustainability. If I'm going to be a peacemaker, how can I do my work in a sustainable way? Because if it's not sustainable, you do it for a couple of years, and then you run out of money, and then it's over. And the only way to make something sustainable is to make it a business. So we started thinking about a business idea. I should have put this slide earlier. It was about the refugees. So I started thinking, what kind of idea that would do peace building, but also people will pay money to do it? Which is not easy, because the moment you say, come to a peace thing, people won't pay that much for that. So we thought about creating a project where people can work, learning to work together, and can make a peaceful impact. And that was travel. When I was 6, 7 years old, remember the photo I showed you earlier, was a cute kid, and tourists will pass by me, and they'll get very, very, very close, and they'll snap a photo of me. And I enjoyed it. I liked the attention. And then they would run away very quickly to join their tour leader, because they were with a group and they in a hurry to do something. And I felt objectified. I felt, wait a second, it's fine, take the photo, I enjoy that, but can you spend 1 minute talking to me? Can you say hello? I knew only 10 words in English anyway. It wouldn't have taken that long. I would have said them very quickly. Hello, hi, peace, bye. That was pretty much 4 words. That was pretty much it. But I really wanted to have the conversation. And I went to school at the mosque, at the Aqsa Mosque, part of my elementary school. And so I've seen tons of tourists, and they'll pass by, take all these photos, and then almost none of them would stop to think about the child they were taking a photo of. We were
objects to them. We were like the stones that were taken photos of. And so I kept thinking about that and thinking, there's something inherently wrong with that. So with another Jewish friend, as you can see, there's a pattern. Pretty much all my projects are done with my Jewish friends. With another Jewish friend, we started a company. And the company was aimed to deal with these kind of problems in travel. We thought, we're going to make people have those conversations, meet the people of the countries they're going to, have dinners like this one is at my parents' home, and this is the best meal you could ever imagine. It's called ma'lube, which means upside down. After you finish cooking it, you flip it upside down, take it out. It just comes out perfectly. And then after we do that, we have some joint band, Israeli and Palestinian musicians. They start playing music, and then everybody starts doing some belly dancing. Can teach you a little later if you want. But it was just incredible to see these kind of things happening. And then we would go sometimes have Shabbat dinners, and then we will go have conversations with politicians, with artists, with religious leaders, priests, pastors, imams, rabbis, and we'll customize the trip based on who we were going with. But we're trying to add these local experiences that are authentic, that are not just a show, but really have those conversations, have a real, honest, open conversations, not to convince the locals of what they're doing wrong, and this is hard sometimes to convey to the travelers, but it's an important thing. You coming to the land to learn, to hear, to grow yourself. You're not just coming to help. You are coming to be part of what they're going through. And it's amazing. Those conversations were changing people's perception about wherever they're going, because no country in the world is homogenous. And when you meet multiple people, you realize there is no one of you and anything anywhere in the world. Just like if somebody comes to Wisconsin, I'm sure there are different opinions and different things. Let's say politics, for example. No place is homogenous. And yet when we travel, somehow we get this one tour guide often, and then we many times do not meet anybody other than that one tour guide. And then our idea of that country is built on the concept of one person, the opinions of one person. And that's not right. So what we did, instead of one tour guide, we thought of building a program with two tour guides in Jerusalem, one Israeli and one Palestinian. And they would lead the tours together and talk about multiple narratives, the narratives of their own communities. For example, when you are standing outside the Western Wall and the Aqsa Mosque, the Jewish guide will talk about how that's important from a Jewish perspective. And then the Palestinian will talk about how that's important from a Muslim perspective. And then they'll have some disagreements. And then they'll go back and forth, not fighting, but having a debate, a very friendly debate. They're not attacking each other. And then the group then can join, because this is not a lecturer. This is now a conversation. And it's not all political. A lot of it has nothing to do with politics. A lot of it has to do with culture, with history, with archaeology, with so many things. One of my friends, well, this guy here, Hossam, who's holding the microphone, he's a Palestinian Muslim who went to school in a Catholic school. So he grew up hearing all about the Catholic narrative of Christianity. I went to a Protestant Bible college. So I learned, I shouldn't have said that in a Catholic college, right? I learned the Protestant point of view. We would be standing in front of the Holy Sepulchre, and this happened quite a few times, me, him, and the Israeli guide. The Israeli guide will sit aside, and he's like, you guys figure it out. And he will, you know, Hossam will talk about how this is where Jesus was crucified and resurrected. And I'll be like, excuse me, there's also a place called the Garden Tomb. And he will go, no, this is the place. And then you have two Muslims arguing about where Jesus was crucified and resurrected. This is what multi-narrative tours is like, is you get suddenly more than one opinion. Instead of me saying, yeah, it's really, I think, there, and some people think it's there. You have people who convinced of these things or who've studied these things, coming from totally different backgrounds, able to tell these stories. And you travel through the whole country doing that. And we realize that that's not only possible there, that's possible everywhere in the world.
It's possible in Ireland, where we have a Catholic and Protestant tour guides. It's possible in Egypt, where we have Christian and Muslim tour guides. It's possible in places where maybe we don't have two tour guides the whole time, but we switching different people and having different speakers. We're doing trips everywhere from Vietnam to Japan to Cuba to all these places, trying to think of making sure that there's not only a dominant narrative that's being shared, that there are multiple narratives, and especially the narratives that are not dominant, they have the right to be shared as much as the main narratives in every country you go to. And so we wanted to create that, to make it available, to make people be able to hear it. And it's a quite a lot of fun to run these kind of trips. But one thing also important to remember, these are not just educationally heavy trips. They're fun. You do religious pilgrimage as you're doing it. You can have cool things to do, like swimming or floating in the Dead Sea, and you should have a National Geographic magazine if you do that, because no other, if you're holding newspaper, the colors are just not good for the photo. So always take with you a Nat Geo magazine if you go into the Dead Sea, and then invite me to take the photo of you. Or Japan, or Vietnam, where you can go and learn fishing and meet people, or it says, you know, it's amazing because when you travel, people always ask you, what's the favorite place you went to, and what was the highlight? And even though in our minds we always think, yeah, it might have been this mountain and this site, in reality, and I know it's at least for me, after I think about it, the highlight are always people, not sites. And so when I went to Vietnam, this was fun. Halong Bay was amazing. Mekong Delta was unbelievably beautiful. But when somebody asked me what was the highlight, this was the highlight. Because this woman, 90 years old, hosted us in her home with her husband, 92, were still farming their own land. That's how they were making their living, hosting some tourists, making some tea, explaining to us stuff that go back from when they were younger at the time of the Vietnam War and telling us all about that and telling us about their lives today and telling us about how, you know, I was asking him what he likes to do and he said, I like some beer. And so you get some beer and you sit together. And it was incredible to hear those kind of stories. And eventually when you come back, this is what stays with you. And it changes your perception of the people there. In D.C. now, we're starting this dual narrative trip. Anybody can guess what the two narratives in D.C.? Washington, D.C.? There are two narratives. No? Yeah, Republican, Democrats, conservatives, and liberals. And it's fascinating to watch it in the States because it's harder to talk about some issues here than in Israel and Palestine. You think Israelis and Palestinians have some issues. We got some real ones here. But this is one way. We don't know how to talk about some of these issues. And so we decided to design the tour to help us figure out how to talk about these conversations, whether it's race issues or whether it's about economy or healthcare. And when you have two tour guides, one is conservative, one is liberal, they're able to have that dialogue. And suddenly the people in the group are also starting to be able to have that dialogue. So what do I want to end with is what does that mean to me? What does that mean to you? This was all over. You talk about so many things. I think at the end of the day, you take what works for you. Amos Oz, who's an Israeli writer, said the following story. He said, if you're walking by and you see a building on fire, what would you do? You have three options. The first one is you get a bucket, you fill it with water, and you throw it in the fire. I killed the story. I missed one part. No, three options. The first option is you run away. And you run away because that's what most people do. If you see a problem, wherever it is, you run away. That's if you see a building on fire, and you think, if I go in to help, I might get burned myself, right? So that's what a lot of people do. When they see global issues or local issues, they think, if I get involved, people are going to say this about me, people are not going to like me, I might get in trouble, I might, so on.
The second option, it's getting a buck, no. Second option is you create a committee to investigate who shall we blame for the fire. By the time you figure out who shall you blame for the fire, everybody in that building would be dead. And often, this is, I think, the number one thing I see people doing. We have these positions and argument about positions and who's right and who's wrong. And at the end of the day, we forget about it's about what we do, not just about what we think. And Facebook and Twitter and so on are great examples because we kind of feel we've done our part. If I wrote that I support this or I support that, I put a like on, you know, whatever, something for helping people. That's not the solution. The solution is you get a bucket, you fill it with water, and you throw it in the fire. But what if you don't have a bucket? You get a cup, you fill it with water, and you throw it in the fire. But what if you don't have a cup? Any guesses? Dirt on it. Okay, that's in you. There's always somebody with a new idea. Dirt on it. Use your hands. Well, he said get a spoon. Shoe is also new. You get a spoon, you fill it with water, and you throw it in the fire. I'll tell you what was the most innovative one. You pee on it. I've had people tell me that. You spit and you pee. Those are the two most innovative ones I've heard. But at the end of the day, the main thing is, it's not that one person with a spoon would put out a fire. But if enough people carry their spoons, buckets, cups, hands, spit, whatever it is, then we can put out the fire. That's the whole thing. It's about thinking, what can I do? Because without each one of us starting to think, what's my role in making a difference? It's not going to change. If we all think somebody else will figure it out. The greatest problem we have, as I travel around the world, the greatest problem I see is indifference. Is when people feel just it's all about politicians. They have to figure it out. What can we do? Nothing is hurting us more than that. And if there's one thing I hope to inspire you with this evening, is for you to think, I can do something. It might not change the whole world. Sure. But if I can make something that can help one person, then that's worth doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Aziz has agreed to take a few questions, if anybody has some. And we've got a couple of students in the back here with microphones, and I have this one here. Maybe we can bring the lights up just a little bit. And if you would raise your hand, then one of these ladies will get a microphone to you, and we have one right away.
I'm wondering what your thoughts are on the work done by the Council on American-Islamic Relations and the American Islamic Forum for Democracy in the United States.
See you. Can you stand up just so I... What's your name?
Nick Saldana.
Okay, can you tell me the question again? I'm sorry.
I wanted to get your thoughts on the work done on international relations from groups like the Council on American Islamic Relations and the American Islamic Forum for Democracy.
On their work in general, that's... The most I know about them, and I'm not that knowledgeable about what they do, the most I know about them is I haven't seen much, but I think it's been good stuff. I think we need more Muslim groups to be engaged. We need more Muslim groups to be engaged, not just in relation to Muslim issues, but in relations to more than that. I like, for example, groups like Islamic Relief, which they have been collecting money from the Muslim community, but when it comes to spending their money on issues, whether in America or overseas, they have decided they're not going to do it only to Muslim communities, but rather to larger communities. I think there's more place and there's a lot more things that could be done. I was especially, as a Palestinian, encouraged the last couple of weeks when we had the attack on the Muslim cemetery and the Jewish cemetery in Kansas. And it was a Palestinian woman who decided to start a campaign to collect money to help fix the damage in the cemetery. And I think we need much more of these kind of things. You need advocacy, you need work that is dealing with how we're dealing with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict or Syria or so on, or hate crimes here in the U.S. But we also have to think about not sticking to only our own community and branch out and help with other communities, because it helps us build also alliances. And it is the right thing to do.
Have you done any work with the Carter Center at all?
I haven't, no. I did meet Carter when he was in Jerusalem a couple of years ago briefly, but no, I haven't done any work with them.
I was wondering if you could say any more about your personal journey. I thought I was going to hear more about the internal emotional journey toward reconciliation that you talked, that the topic of the talk.
Is there anything specific you'd like? I'm happy to touch on it.
I mean, it's such a journey from, as you said, vengeance to forgiveness.
Right.
And you mentioned how the class helped you to see differently, but how do you go through that emotionally? I'm not sure. You know, very personally.
Right. I think there is never... I didn't have a one point of change. And I think that's often what people ask me. When did you really change? And there was no one point. It was a journey, because you are dealing with all these emotions going on and all this anger and every time I read a newspaper, still until today, I read of things happening there. I've had 4 people in my family who have been killed before and after my brother. And so there are moments where you get outraged and you get upset. One of them died in prison as well. But I think for me, it started becoming about, I'm angry, there's nothing I can do about that, but how do I deal with my anger? And will I let my anger lead to hatred, or will it lead to something more positive? And so I just decided to direct my anger more for something positive. And again, it wasn't simple. I've had years of struggle. A struggle for what to understand. Do I need to forgive or not? What does forgiveness even mean? Does it mean that the person who killed my brother is okay now? And, you know, I'm totally cool and yeah, he's all right. My understanding of forgiveness is not that. My understanding of forgiveness became more, no, what happened is wrong, what he did is wrong, but I will not do anything against that person. I still think, justice-wise, they should be held responsible, and unfortunately, they're not. But I will not let that person control my life. And this is maybe an important part, is I felt until I was 18, my life was not under my own choices. It was not me who was making decisions. Every time I got up and I was angry and I was mad, it was not me who was making the choices. It was the person who killed my brother who was making the choices for me. I was living according to their action. I was just reacting to them. And when I realized that, I decided I'm going to break away from that, because it doesn't matter what somebody does to you. You still have the full ability to make your own choices. And again, it sounds simple and it sounds easy, but it took me years to overcome that. And even when I started working with Israelis like Rami is very unique guy, but we lived in a conflict zone. So we would have people getting killed and we would hear stories and there'll be a bombing here and there'll be a shelling here. And we would talk about it. And sometimes we had some serious arguments, because we were still ourselves you know, it's our families who are being involved. And when a few years ago, an 18-month-year-old kid from my family was killed because of tear gas. And that made the whole family just go crazy. Eight, 9 months ago, my nephew was going to buy groceries to host the tour guide you saw earlier, Yuval, over for dinner. So we had an Israeli guy coming over for dinner, and he was going to buy groceries, and 10 or so extremists, Israeli, attacked him, yelling that kill him, kill him. They caught him, they dislocated his shoulder. He was able to escape. And you hear that, and you go mad, you go terrified. But the same day that happened, I had also a friend, a Jewish friend, who was almost stabbed by a Palestinian on that day, and my mind was going crazy. I almost lost my nephew and my friend on the same day. And these things continue to happen, and the struggle, the emotional struggle, I think, continues to happen. But I try to think about it more. These things are not going to change, but if I give in to emotions and to reactions, I become part of the problem instead of part of the solution. And also, I don't see people as us versus them in the sense of Israelis versus Palestinians. I really see it as those of us who believe in living existence, coexistence, being with each other, and those of us who don't. And we have both. And so I don't see Rami as a Jewish person on the other side. If I'm in trouble, whatever it is, I'm serious when I tell you the first phone call I do is to him. He's the first person I call. And I don't think of him anymore as the other because he's gotten me out of so many troubles. You got no idea. I do get myself in a lot of troubles. So, yes. She's getting it to you.
I'm just wondering how you're able to travel. I have friends in Bethlehem.
I'm an American citizen now.
And so when you go back and forth?
That doesn't work, no. My American citizenship does not apply to Israel. You're still a Palestinian when it comes to Israel. I do because I'm a Jerusalem resident, so I can go to Jerusalem. The rules are it's much easier for me than somebody from Bethlehem. It's much harder for me than somebody from Nazareth. So there's all these different groups, and each one, depending on your category, it's different. So from Jerusalem, we have the same status, kind of like a green card holder in the U.S., which sounds good, except just like we had recently in the U.S., you actually could at any point lose that status for whatever reason, political reason, legal reason, so on. So you don't have a stability in your life. You can travel wherever, but you don't have the right to vote. You have the right to health care, but so it's different. While in the West Bank, you don't have those rights. Travel is a lot harder for somebody from the West Bank. Getting out, you have to always, regardless where you are, you have to go through Israel. Doesn't matter if you live in Ramallah or if you live in Jerusalem, you have to go through Israel, has to approve your way in and out, or Gaza. It's all the same. But the moment you even go to Jordan, because that's the only way you would be able to travel, you first have to go to Jordan, then good luck getting a visa to anywhere in the world because nobody wants to give a visa to a Palestinian. And whether it's for work, I mean, for many years, it was a nightmare. And my job is all about travel. And it was a nightmare for me to travel anywhere because no one would give you a visa because the moment they see you're Palestinian, that's pretty much it. And your career would be destroyed because of that.
First of all, I just wanted to thank you so much again for your work and for sharing your story. My question as a college student in northern Wisconsin, and just as, I guess, the millennial generation, where we're so used to seeing images, but feeling powerless with, like, the situations at hand, What is your suggestion for how we should approach that in the future?
And the Israeli-Palestinian?
Really with any conflict, because I feel like we see things and we have these emotional responses but feel powerless because not like the generations before us haven't done like a good enough job or anything, but just our situation.
I would start a bit different. I would say one thing that is hard for us to do, it's easier to see other problems in the world and get involved in those sometimes because they're less emotional, and sometimes it's harder to do at home. So I've been doing a lot of work internationally, and I realize now that Washington is my home, I need to start doing stuff in my own city first because this is where I live. And so my first advice would be think about where are the divisions in your own city and how can you get involved here, where you can volunteer to make a difference here. What are the invisible lines here where people don't cross and don't see each other and don't understand each other? And wherever I've been, those lines always exist. So I would start in that place. Second, I think you have to be aware that you have to educate yourself a lot on the issue. And what I do, I try to read multiple news and writings that are not in agreement with each other so I can understand people's perception. Not because I agree with everything I read. I have obviously my views. But I want to know the people who are on the other side, what they think, where are they coming from, what they're going in their mind. So in Israel, I read pretty much everything from the right to the left because I wanted to really understand the multiple points of view of everyone, and the same on the Palestinian side. And when I came here to the States, I read pretty much, again, everything from the right to the left. And it's not easy, and it can get you really upset depending on where you are politically. But I think it's really important to educate yourself on people's perception. Again, I don't mean it as there's no facts and you can accept everything. I mean it as knowing where people are getting their information from, what they think. And that would help you in engaging in conversations with people on this issue. I think there's a problem in the culture of dialogue here in the U.S., just as it is there, where people have a hard time listening when they disagree with somebody. I think that part is important, is being able to create those meetings and those dialogues where people can have conversations, do something together. I was just meeting with a friend of mine who's a pastor in D.C., and he was asking a similar question to you. And I said, don't even just meet, learn, but start doing some things together. Start going and considering all these things happening, like there was another attack on a Jewish cemetery in Philadelphia, and said, I think what would have been great if that church meets with a mosque, meets with a synagogue, and they send 20, 30 people to go and fix some of those graves. We need more action also oriented things, and there's so much stuff happening here. I don't know if Green Bay has any refugees, reaching out to those and being able to help with them, because the hardest thing of being a refugee is having a friend and being accepted by the community you are coming to. So there's so much we can do even before we step outside our own community. And then if you want to go and volunteer in a Syrian refugee camp or an educational camp, one of the things we did, I didn't mention, is we started educational camps for kids. And we do that every few months, and we always look for volunteers. So it's all done by volunteers. There's no fundraising. Everyone fundraises their own trip if they need to. But if you want to come, sure. And you can go on the trip.
Yeah, that's right. And I was also going to say, if you want to talk about any of those things some more with some of us here on campus at the Norman Miller Center, at the Sturzel Center for Community Service and Learning, Cassandra Voss Center, we have a lot of programs meant to cross some of those bridges and get people involved. So I think we have time for one more, and you have been patient down here, sir. Do you still have a question for
If anybody else wants a question, I will stay here, come to me after, and or we can meet outside and we can talk. I'm not in a hurry to go anywhere.
And I've just read a few articles, like in journals and things, about life in the refugee camps. Could you maybe elaborate on and just how horrendous life is in these camps?
Oh, they are They are definitely horrible. So one of the worst things, I think, is the idea of not being able to leave. The moment you are in, and you might spend 2-3 years where you can't leave. And this is true wherever. This is the way most refugee camps function. You live in a prison. You don't have a job. And you can imagine what kind of thing happens to you if you live for 2 years or 3 years, have nothing. You in that tent, and you spend all your time in that tent, and that's it. Many people don't feel comfortable sending their kids to school because they don't feel it is safe, because when people are not working and they have nothing to do, they become more angry, and violence can get on the rise in those camps. You receive your food, water, all of that from the UN or from whichever organizations that are there. So you never have a choice even in what you're eating, what you're drinking, what you're doing. It's really the best way to explain it. It's just an open prison. And the idea of it is that it's temporary. However, in the conflicts we have today, it's not. Because the Syrian conflict started 6 years ago, 5-6 years ago, and yet it's still going on. The Za'atari camp, the land was rented for, I think, 8 years, and it's likely to be renewed again, and still more and more people are coming. The area closest to Jordan, Dar'a, is being attacked at the moment by ISIS, and it's likely that many, many more people are gonna end up escaping toward Jordan. Now, there's in Jordan about 1 million refugees. In Turkey, there's over 2.5 million. The numbers keep going up. I can't track anymore. In Lebanon, a country of 4 million people has over 1.5 million refugees. I mean, you look at these places, and they have a lot of problems. There's many things we can criticize in each one of these countries. But on the other hand, I think about us in the U.S. If we took that number of refugees per population, that would be over 120 million refugees. I mean, can you imagine we taking 120 million refugees? And yet, they've done that. Now, again, there are many issues, there are many problems. But which country can handle 30% increase of population without major problems? So I, on one hand, I think there are a lot of things that need to change in these countries with how they're dealing with refugees, but also I'm understanding that what they're doing is way beyond their abilities. Jordan is one of the poorest countries in the world when it comes to water. A growth of 20% of population in 3 years, water-wise, it created a crisis. Prices-wise, it created a crisis. So it's not easy, and I applaud these countries for what they're doing despite all the shortcomings that they are going through.
Me once again in thanking Aziz Abu Sarah. So again, as you leave, if you do have questions about this upcoming trip and you'd like to talk to me or Fuad Al-Khoury in the back, we will be out in the lobby area, happy to answer any questions you may have. If you want to come down front here and talk some more to Aziz, please feel free.